Time for one of our favorite segments of the week, when the media covers itself in glory. Krystal and I break it down, and Katie Halper always joins us. We've got some really good stuff for you guys this week. I'm excited.
That's right. Katie Halper joins us now, co-host of Useful Idiots podcast and host of the Katie Halper Show. And we've been talking to you about not just the media, but you are in the center of a media story right now, and in fact have a new piece in The Guardian that we wanted to talk to you about, explaining partly why and how you covered the Tara Reade allegations against Joe Biden. Just talk to us a little bit about the piece and what you lay out.
Sure. So hi, guys. Thanks again for having me. Love to talk
to
you guys.
Great to see you. We always love to.
Thank you. You guys brought this up a little bit a couple of episodes ago when you had Tara on, or when you were talking about Tara, because you were one of the few places brave enough to and responsible enough to actually air a woman's credible allegation against Joe Biden. Especially ironic that the silence around it has been especially ironic when it's from the very people who usually support Me Too. And you, as you said, Krystal, we really wanted people like you and me, we really wanted journalists to take on this story and take it seriously and kind of go at it the way that they had with Christine Blasey Ford. And you interviewed Ryan Grimm, who broke the Christine Blasey Ford story. And the responses to that, I just interviewed him myself, actually. It's on the latest episode of the Katie Halper Show. But the responses to that story were so different from the responses to this one. And it's just not justifiable. Again, I believe Christine Blasey Ford. I believe Tara Reade. But what you can't do is hold them to such different standards. And you guys have pointed that out really wonderfully. So in this piece, I go through why I interviewed her, because a kind of initial round of attacks against Tara from self-identified liberal feminists. I'll call myself a leftist feminist, but self-identified liberal feminists, their kind of first round of attack against Tara was that they knew that they couldn't overtly try to discredit her or smear her, because that's so off-brand, because their brand is Believe Women. So what they did was they kind of went after me, and they went after Ryan Grimm, which is really ridiculous, because again, Ryan Grimm is the guy who broke the Christine Blasey Ford story, and Ryan Grimm is a guy who's been nominated for Pulitzer Prizes. Yeah. So come on, like, choose your targets, like, go after me, fine. But so I responded to that, and I was like, you know what, fine. Yeah, I didn't want to be the person to initially break this interview. And if the media were at all responsible, if liberal feminists who went fully after Brett Kavanaugh, if they had been doing their job, I wouldn't have had to have done this either. You know, other people would have looked into it, but they didn't. And it's a real disservice. It's a disservice to, obviously, I would say, to Tara Reade. It's a disservice to the Me Too movement. It opens us on the left up to a lot of accusations and allegations of hypocrisy. And at the end of the article, I did something because I kind of wanted to extend an olive branch and acknowledge that there are people who... So for Tara, it's very understandable. She doesn't want Biden to be the next, to be the nominee. And a lot of the things that have been said about Tara, by the way, as you guys know, are totally untrue. This idea that her timing was suspicious. No, she's been trying to tell this for a year and was turned away precisely by Time's Up, which exists precisely to help women come forward with their allegations. It's not like she came out yesterday, right? She was trying to come out for a year. And all the arguments against her, another one is that she said some nice things about Joe Biden. And again, people who are sexually assaulted frequently have conflicted feelings towards the person who has assaulted them. And again, my feminist sisters know this more than anyone else, because these are the kind of rape denying arguments that are so often used against people that we defend. So it's just so disturbing. So that's another myth. And the other myth is that it's somehow suspicious that she's mad at that. It's suspicious that she would like the one guy in the race who's not the person she accused of sexually assaulting her. Like, why is that suspicious? That's just logical.
One thing, Katie, I know that you, I think you were about to go to that point there, was you were extending an olive branch talking about. I think I've said this here on the show, too. I'm like, look, if you want to just say, like, it's a zero-sum game, I have to choose, I choose. Fine. I can't accept that. That is something that people make that calculation all the time. But to gaslight and not have the same standard, that's what I think makes us all so mad about this one.
Look, Saagar, you, Krystal, we are turning Saagar into an intersectional feminist. Look at him dropping terms like gaslight around. But it, no, that's precisely it.
I was saying this during Kavanaugh, so he wouldn't love me then.
Okay. But like, that's precisely it. I understand that there are people who say, you know what, it sucks. I can't believe we're being forced to choose between two men facing credible allegations of sexual assault. I understand people who are like, look, the priority is defeating Trump. I think that there are lots of, it's a complicated thing and there are lots of moral issues at play. But what you can't do is, because you don't want to go there and you don't want to publicly grapple with these issues, you can't then trash and smear Tara Reade. You can, but you're a bad person and you're a hypocrite and you're harming the Me Too movement. But that is really one of the major issues. And again, I think that there is a lot of shaming that happens on both sides. So you have two groups of people, one group among the left, right? One group says, I refuse to engage in an election between two alleged rapists, sexual assaulters. The other side is, that's horrible. And also, yeah, why are we choosing between these guys? And if Tara had been listened to earlier, we wouldn't be choosing between these two guys. But the priority is defeating Trump. And then there's a third group that's like, we need to just get rid of Biden and defeat him that way. Anyway, all of those have valuable moral like framing. But it's the thing that I can't stand are the people who know that they know that it's wrong to trash someone and to smear someone and hold someone up to standards that are different to the standards they hold up other women when it's politically inconvenient. And so, again, I think that, again, I don't blame people who are saying, you know what, sorry, this guy has better policies than Trump and he faces fewer sexual assault allegations. I also don't blame people for saying, this is not how we win. We don't run on a campaign of the guy who's been accused of sexually assaulting fewer people. So my point is, though, what's not acceptable is just the ideological political vanity or the kind of cowardice that prevents people from actually grappling with these things and just turns them
into... Yeah, I think that's...
Yeah, because... Exactly right. And actually, you know, Ruth Marcus of the Washington Post, to her credit, look, her column wasn't perfect, but she at least acknowledged, like, I recognize that I have a bias here that predisposes me to basically dismiss those allegations. I was like, at least you're honest about that, right? Like, that to me was important. We also wanted to talk to you, though, because your Nancy Pelosi commentary is always so on point. There was a moment this week that really caught our eye where, of course, in the midst of this pandemic, Pelosi was on a late night show and she was displaying how she is getting through this moment. Let's take a look at that.
Oh my, wow.
Other people in our family go for some other flavors, but chocolate, and then we have some other chocolate here.
So lots of abundance there, lots of ice cream, plenty of goodies for her.
I'm not gonna lie.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry, I cut you off. Yeah. I'm not going to lie. I'm a chocolate person. So that's one of the areas where I have an ideological overlap with her.
Oh, yeah. Right. Well, and you should acknowledge your bias in that direction.
Exactly.
Right. That's honest.
Right.
That's honest. We appreciate that. So the Trump campaign picked up on this and they cut an ad, you know, basically super cutting Nancy Pelosi with her chocolate and her fancy fridge, $24,000 fridge with the $12 ice cream pints all stacked up, these images of abundance with Americans waiting in line, miles long lines for food banks and the unemployment numbers, et cetera. Well, the ladies at The View decided to tackle this story and predictably took Pelosi's side and attempted to defend her. Let's take a listen to that.
So I want to point out that the ice cream she's talking about actually comes from a small business. I know that because I send this ice cream out to people. And she is one of the people that is fighting to make sure that small businesses are able to get the testing they need and the stuff that they need.
Well-reasoned analysis, as we always see from Whoopi and Joy Behar, right? You know, it's a small business, right? I mean, I should be supporting small businesses, right, Katie?
By the way, very just coming full circle, ironically, part of the reason that Tara Reade came forward in 2019 with the allegations of inappropriate touching and sexual harassment was precisely because she saw on The View they were tearing down Lucy Flores. Lucy Flores had accused Biden of making her feel uncomfortable. After she did that, seven other women came forward, including Tara. So that's kind of funny. So, you know, The View does have a big... The View is, it didn't even know it, but they're behind this Tara Reade movement, ironically, you know? But, again, I think that Nancy Pelosi, what I wanted Nancy Pelosi to do, I thought her resistance move would have been to take a bag of Cheetos and like light it on fire, and that would have been her equivalent of her clapping and ripping up Trump's speech. But she didn't do that. But what she did do was basically walked into a great ad for the Trump campaign by looking extremely out of touch. And I mean, to be fair, I also think that Trump is a great, he's just very good at trolling. And I don't, you know, Trump is not salt of the earth. And there's been, the Dems and Republicans have been doing terrible things during this pandemic. And, but it's true that they just need better optics. I mean, Dems just need to work on not showing off their, they're in a bit of a bind, because if they opened up their refrigerator and they had just like, or if they went into their kitchen, they had like a what's it called? A freezer? What are those things called? Not a freezer. A cooler.
Yes.
Like if Nancy Pelosi opened up a beer cooler and had like, you know, like, I don't know, Doritos and
or like Elizabeth Warren. Yeah, right? That'd be like Elizabeth I'm going to get me a beer.
Let me get me a beer. A beer.
But then what we would need is then Nancy Pelosi's husband would have to come into the frame and be like, no, that's okay. And that would be the Warren night.
Be like, we don't drink beer. Where's the cab?
Yeah.
All right. I mean,
fair point. Right. Very fair point. Katie, so great to see
you.
Thank you as always.
Appreciate it.
All right, thanks.
We'll have more for you later today.